man.
Aye, little buttercup, and well called, for you're the rosiest, the roundest, and the reddest beauty in all Spitty.
Aye!
Red am I, and round and rosy. Maybe, for I have dissembled well. But hark ye, my merry friend, hast ever thought that beneath a gay and frivolous exterior there may lurk a cankerworm, which is slowly but surely eating its way into one's very heart?
No, me lass, I can't say I've ever thought that.
I've thought it, often.
Yes, you look like it. What's the matter with the man? Isn't he well?
Don't take no heed of him. That's only poor Dick Deadeye.
I say, it's a beast of a name, ain't it? Dick Deadeye.
It's not a nice name.
I'm ugly too, ain't I?
You are certainly plain.
And I'm three-cornered too, ain't I?
You are rather triangular.
Yeah, that's it. I'm ugly and they hate me for it. For you all hate me, don't you?
We do!
There.
Well, Dick, we wouldn't go for to hurt any fellow creature's feelings. But you can't expect a chap with such a name as Dick Deadeye to be a popular character now, can you?
No.
It's asking too much, ain't
it? It is. From such a face and form as mine, the noblest sentiments sound like the black utterances of a depraved imagination. It's human nature. I'm resigned.
But tell me, who's the youth whose faltering feet with difficulty bear him on his course?
That is the smartest lad in all the fleet, Rafe Rackstraw.
Rafe, that name! Remorse, remorse.
captain's child won't have nothing to say to a poor chap like you. Will she, lads?
No, no, captain's daughters don't marry foremost hands.
Deadeye, them sentiments of yourn are a disgrace to our common nature.
But it's a strange anomaly that the daughter of a man who hails from the quarterdeck may not love another who lays out on the foyardarm. For a man is but a man, whether he hoists his flag at the main truck or he slacks on the main deck.
Aye, it's a queer world.
Dick Deadeye, I have no desire to press hardly on you, but such a revolutionary sentiment is enough to make an honest sailor shudder.
Me lads, our gallant captain has come on deck. Let us greet him as so brave an officer and so gallant a seaman deserves.
My gallant crew, good morning.
Sir, good morning.
I hope you're all quite well.
Quite well. And you, sir?
I am in reasonable health and happy to meet you all once more.
You do us proud, sir.
Pinafore.
And a rightful captain too.
You're very, very good, and be it understood, I command a right good crew.
We're very, very good, and be it understood, we command a right good crew.
You're related to our peer, I can hand, beef and steer, or ship a silver G. I am never known to quail in the fury of a gale, and I never, never sink at sea.
What, never?
No, never.
What, never?
Well, hardly ever.
He's hardly ever sick at sea.
Then he pinches and one cheer more for the hardy captain of the Pinafore. He pinches and one cheer more for the captain of the Pinafore. I do my best to satisfy you all.
And you were quite content.
You're exceedingly polite, and I think it only right to return the compliment.
We're exceedingly polite, and it is only right to return the compliment.
Bad language or abuse, I never, never use, whatever the emergency. The moment I may occasionally say, I never use a big, big D.
What, never?
No, never.
What, never?
Well, hardly ever.
Hardly ever says a big, big D.
Josephine, the fairest flower that ever blossomed on ancestral timber, is sought in marriage by Sir Joseph Porter, our Admiralty's first lord. But for some reason, she does not seem to tackle kindly to it. Daughter, I go fair.
child. I grieve to see that you're a prey to melancholy. You should look your best today, for Sir Joseph Porter, K.C.B, will be here this afternoon to claim your promised hand.
Ah, father, your words cut me to the quick. I can esteem, reverence, venerate Sir Joseph, for he is a great and good man. But, oh, I cannot love him. My heart is already given.
It is then as I feared. Given? And to whom? Not to some gilded lordling.
No, father. The object of my love is no lordling. Oh, pity me, for he is but a humble sailor on board your own ship.
Impossible.
Yes, it is true, too true.
A common sailor? Oh, fie.
I blush for the weakness that allows me to cherish such a passion. I hate myself when I think of the depths to which I have stooped in permitting myself to think tenderly of one so ignobly born. But I love him. I love him. I love him.
Come, my child, let us talk this over. In a matter of the heart, I would not coerce my daughter. I attach but little value to rank or wealth. But the line must be drawn somewhere. A man in that station may be brave and worthy, but at every step he would commit solecisms that society would never pardon.
Oh, I have thought of this night and day. But fear not, father. I have a heart, and therefore I love. But I am your daughter, and therefore I am proud. Though I carry my love with me to the tomb, he shall never, never know it.
You are my daughter, after all. But see, Sir Joseph's barge approaches, manned by 12 trusty oarsmen, and accompanied by the admiring crowd of sisters, cousins, and aunts that attend him wherever he goes. Retire, my daughter, to your cabin. Take this, his photograph, with you. It may help to bring you to a more reasonable frame of mind.
My own thoughtful father. Oh!
Thank you. monarch of the sea, the ruler of the Queen's Navy, whose praise Great Britain loudly chants.
And we are his sisters and his cousins and his aunts.
And we are his sisters and his cousins and his aunts. His sisters and his cousins and his aunts.
When at anchor here I ride, my bosom swells with pride, and I snap my fingers at the foreman's taunts.
And so do his sisters and his cousins and his aunts.
And so do his sisters and his cousins and his aunts. His sisters and his cousins and his aunts.
When the breezes blow, I generally go below and seek the seclusion that a cabin grants.
And so do his sisters and his cousins and his aunts.
And so do his sisters and his cousins and his aunts.
And so do his sisters and his cousins and his aunts. His sisters and his cousins and his aunts. His sisters and his cousins and his aunts.
Sailor is a splendid fellow, Captain Corcoran.
A splendid fellow indeed, Sir Joseph.
I hope you treat your crew kindly, Captain Corcoran.
Indeed, I hope so, Sir Joseph.
Never forget that they are the bulwarks of England's greatness, Captain Corcoran.
So I have always considered them, Sir Joseph.
No bullying, I trust. No strong language of any kind, eh?
Oh, never, Sir Joseph.
What, never?
Well, hardly ever, Sir Joseph. They are an excellent crew and do their work thoroughly without it.
Don't patronise them, sir. Pray don't patronise them.
Certainly not, Sir Joseph.
That you are their captain is an accident of birth. I cannot permit these noble fellows to be patronized, because an accident of birth has placed you above them and them below you.
I am the last person to insult a British sailor, Sir Joseph.
You are the last person who did, Captain Corcoran. Desire that splendid seaman to step forward. No, no, the other splendid seaman.
Rave Rackstraw, 3 paces to the front, march!
If what?
I beg your pardon, I don't think I understand you.
If you please.
Oh, yes, of course. If you please.
You're a remarkably fine fellow.
Yes, Your Honor.
And a first-rate seaman, I'd be bound.
There's not a smarter topman in the Navy, Your Honor, though I say who shouldn't.
Not at all. Proper self-respect, nothing more. Can you dance a hornpipe?
No, Your Honor.
That's a pity. All sailors should dance hornpipes. I will teach you one this evening, after dinner. Now tell me, don't be afraid.
How does your captain treat you, eh?
A better captain. Don't walk the deck, Your Honor.
Aye!
Good. I like to hear you speak well of your commanding officer. I dare say he don't deserve it. But still it does you credit. Can you sing?
I can hum a little, Your Honor.
Oh, then, hum this at your leisure. It is a song that I have composed for the use of the Royal Navy. It is designed to encourage independence of thought and action in the lower branches of the service, and to teach the principle that a British sailor is any man's equal, excepting mine. Now, Captain Corcoran, a word with you in your cabin on a tender and sentimental subject.
Aye, aye, Sir Joseph. Boatswain, in commemoration of this joyous occasion, see that extra grog is served out to the ship's company at 7 bells.
Beg pardon? If what, Your Honor?
If what? I don't think I understand you.
If you please, Your Honor.
What?
The gentleman is quite right. If you please.
If you please.
For I hold that on the seas, the expression, if you please, a particularly gentlemanly tone implants.
And so do his sisters and his cousins and his aunts.
And so do his sisters and his cousins and his aunts. His sisters and his cousins and their records of their cousins and his aunts.
I, Sir Joseph, a true gentleman. Courteous and considerate to the very humblest.
True, Boatswain, but we are not the very humblest. Sir Joseph has explained our true position to us. As he says, a British seaman is any man's equal, excepting his. And if Sir Joseph says that, is it not our duty to believe him?
Well, well, sir!
You're on a wrong tack, and so is he. He means well, but he don't know. When people have to obey other people's orders, equality's out of the question.
Horrible!
Dick Deadeye, if you go for to infuriate this year's ship's company too far, I won't answer for being able to hold them in. I'm shocked, that's what I am. Shocked.
Messmates, my mind's made up. I'll speak to the captain's daughter and tell her, like an honest man, of the honest love I have for her.
Aye.
Is not my love as good as another's?
Yes.
Is not my heart as true as another's?
Yes.
Have I not hands and eyes and ears and limbs like another?
Aye.
True, I lack
a berth on board this very ship.
Well said, I had forgotten that. Messmates, what do you say? Do you approve my determination?
We do!
I don't! What's to be done with this here hopeless chap?
Let us sing him the song that Sir Joseph has kindly composed for us. Perhaps it will bring this here miserable creature to a proper state of mind.
A British star is a soaring soul, as free as a mountain bird. His energetic fist should be ready to resist a dictatorial world.
His nose should
bend,
as his lips should curve.
His cheek should flame,
and his brow should
rouse. His bosom should be,
and his heart should glow,
and his fist be ever ready for the knout.
Down, down.
His nose should bend, and his lips should
flesh,
and his breast throws blood,
and that this should be his custom merry yet.
This foot should sample his heart, should crown his head, should twirl his face, should scalp his eye, should flesh his breast from true, and this should be his custom merry yet.
I know that he's a truly great and good man, for he told me so himself. But to me he seems tedious, fretful, and dictatorial. Yet, his must be a mind of no common order, or he would not dare to teach my dear father to dance a hornpipe on the cabin table. Ralph Rackstraw.
Aye, lady. No other than poor Ralph Rackstraw.
How my heart beats. And why poor Ralph?
I am poor in the essence of happiness, lady, rich only in never-ending unrest. In me there meet a combination of antithetical elements which are at eternal war with one another, driven hither by objective influences, thither by subjective emotions, wafted one moment into blazing day by mocking hope, plunged the next into the Cimmerian darkness of tangible despair. I am but a living ganglion of irreconcilable antagonisms. I hope I make myself clear, lady.
Perfectly. His simple eloquence goes to my heart. Oh, if I dared. But no, the thought is madness. Dismiss these foolish fancies. They torture you but needlessly. Come, make one effort.
I will. One. Joseph.
Sir.
I, even though Jove's armor ever launched at the head of the audacious mortal whose lips, unhallowed by relationship, dared to breathe that precious word, yet would I breathe it once, and then, perchance, be silent evermore. Josephine, in one brief breath I will concentrate the hopes, the doubts, the anxious fears of 6 weary months. Josephine, I am a British sailor, and I love you.
Sir, this audacity! Oh, my heart, my beating heart. This unwarrantable presumption on the part of a common sailor. Common, oh, the irony of the word. Oh, sir, you forget the disparity in our ranks.
I forget nothing, haughty lady. I love you desperately. My life is in your hand. I lay it at your feet. Give me hope. And what I lack in education and polite accomplishments, that I will endeavor to acquire. Drive me to despair, and in death alone I shall look for consolation. I am proud and cannot stoop to implore. I have spoken, and I wait your word.
You shall not wait long. Your proffered love I haughtily reject. Go, sir, and learn to cast your eyes on some village maiden in your own poor rank. They should be lowered before your captain's daughter. Refrain, audacious tar, your beautiful dressing. Refrain for what you are, and you are dressing. Refrain, audacious tar, your beautiful dressing. Remember what you are, who are dressing. Refrain, audacious tar. Remember what you are. I'd laugh my rank to scorn in you now.
Well,
loneliest star that saves the water, and you, proud maiden, are thy captain's daughter. Proud lady, have your way. You speak, and I obey. My heart with anguish torn bows down before her. She loves my love to scorn, yet I adore her. My
life I'm taking for Daughter, and you, the meanest slave.